everyone. I'm Dr. Rizwana, working as a professor of physics in Institute of Aeronautical Engineering. Today, I'm going to discuss different types of questions that can be asked related to semiconductor devices. You can see in my previous videos that we have discussed a lot about different semiconductors, of course, types of semiconductor materials, and then after that, how these semiconductor materials can be used in order to get different semiconductor devices, which are also called as optoelectronic. We have focused in semiconductor devices, basically optoelectronic devices, where we have conversion of light energy to electrical energy or electrical energy to light energy. So coming to our question bank, first we are going to discuss about short answer questions, where answer it should be given in short form related to particular question. So coming to first question, as you can see, illustrate how potential barrier prevents the diffusion of electrons and holes across the junction. So as we know that, what exactly is p-n junction? When we form p-n junction, of course, p-n junction, it is formed by combining p-type and n-type semiconductor. And once p-n junction is formed, here we know that in p-type semiconductors, we have majority charge carriers holes. And in n-type semiconductors, we have majority charge carriers electrons. And of course, in n-type semiconductors, here when we talk about holes, they are very small in number. Whereas in a p-type semiconductor, electrons are very small in number. So automatically, if there is change in their concentration, then we'll have flow of charge carriers from higher concentration to lower concentration region. So same thing takes place here. Now holes, they try to move from p-type material to n-type material. Similarly, electrons from n-type material to p-type material takes place. Of course, this process is nothing but diffusion. But there is like after some time, there will be stopped to further diffusion. This occurs because once holes, so here what we have to write here is holes from p-type, when they go to n-type, so here suppose I have my p-type and this is n-type, and here we have our holes and here we have our electrons. And these holes, okay, when they move towards the inside, what they are going to do once they move to inside, they are going to lose their energy to electrons. Or we can also say that these holes, they combine with electrons, they'll become neutral and they'll lose their energy. And of course, if this is the junction layer, then these holes, when they come to this side, they'll become positive ions, immobile positive ions. So these holes, they'll become immobile positive ions. These are without energy. And similarly, electrons, when they slide from N side to P side, so when they come here, these electrons, they lose their energy to holes and they'll become immobile negative ions. And because of these positive and negative ions, and of course, as I told you, they are not free charge carriers, they are immobile. And because of this charge separation, a potential voltage is developed across the junction. That potential voltage, it is called as potential barrier. So this is called as potential barrier. And of course, this region where we have immobile charge carriers, both positive as well as negative, that layer, it is called as depletion layer, layer which is depleted of charge carriers. So, and what is the role played by this potential barrier? This potential barrier, because it is restricting, it will like create one barrier voltage, which will stop further diffusion of electrons and holes across the junction. So now coming to second question, explain the terms charge carrier generation and recombination in semiconductors. Now, what is generation? Generally, if we take our semiconductors, so we know that best example to explain our semiconductors are silicon and germanium. Suppose if we take silicon, so here we have silicon and germanium. So if we take silicon, we know that it belongs to group 4 and which has got 4 valence electrons. So it is going to form 4 covalent bonds with adjacent silicon atoms, right? So they are going to form 4 covalent bonds with adjacent silicon atoms. So there are no free electrons. And this condition, when we try to explain it in terms of energy level diagram, we can say that, yeah, if I consider EV as a topmost energy level of valence band and EC as topmost energy, bottommost energy level of conduction band, here all these electrons which are taking part in covalent bond formation, these electrons are nothing but electrons in valence band. So these are the electrons in valence band. So now what we are going to see here is generally if we take intrinsic semiconductors, when we go to high temperatures, it means that we are supplying energy to semiconductor material. What happens to all these covalent bonds? These covalent bonds will break up. Now, electrons, they are not in bound state. So, they'll come out of their covalent bonds and they'll be in free state. So, they'll act as free charge carriers. It means that thermal energy in the form of heat, which we are supplying, it will be absorbed by all those electrons which are present in the valence band. And what happens to these electrons? These electrons, they'll go to excited state. That excited state is nothing but conduction band. As a result, suppose if one electron goes from valence band to conduction band, then what happens in valence band when hole is generated? Then what happens in conduction band? One electron, free electron will be created. And this phenomena, it is known as electron hole pair formation. And depending upon how many number of transitions are taking place from valence band to conduction band, we are going to have so many number of electron hole pairs. So this is the process of generation of electron hole pairs. Now, coming to recombination process. In recombination process, of course, we know that when we supply energy to semiconductors, it will become conductor. And we have our electrons now in conduction band and they are taking part in conductivity. So, when we talk about recombination process, so here when we talk about recombination process, we have our electrons in conduction band. So, this is our conduction band and this is our valence band. So, after getting energy, electrons, they are there in conduction band. Now, what we are going to observe here is, there are two ways of making these electrons come back to valence band. One type is after their lifetime. So, we know that every energy level, it is going to have its own lifetime. So, after their lifetime, what happens to these electrons? These electrons, they will lose their energy spontaneously and they'll come down. Okay, and when they are coming down here, energy will be released. So, what we have to understand here is for generation of electron hole pairs, generally we have to supply energy. But in case of recombination, what we are going to observe here is when electron comes from higher state to lower state, it is going to release energy. And how much energy will be released? Energy which is equal to this band gap Eg. So, this band gap Eg, which is Ec minus Ev, so that much energy will be released, and this process, it is called as recombination, because electron, it is coming back to its original vacant site. So, here electrons and holes, they are combining, they are becoming neutral. So, now there won't be any free electron in conduction band, there won't be any free hole in valence band. So, this phenomena, it is called as recombination, and this is the one way. Where this process is occurring spontaneously. Another way is where I have to make these electrons, like we are pushing these electrons down to the valence band. So when we push these electrons to valence band, and how that pushing can be done? Either by supplying energy, electrical energy. So electrical energy means, suppose if I forward pass PN junction, and when we forward pass, generally what will happen? What is forward passing? Suppose if I have taken PN junction, and here in this case, forward biasing is nothing but where P-type of PN junction it is connected to positive terminal and N-type of PN junction is connected to negative terminal. So, these holes, they are suffering repulsion from negative terminal of battery. So, they'll go towards the inside, and similarly, electrons which are present in N-type material, they'll suffer repulsion from negative terminal. They'll go towards the P-type. Now, here, what exactly is happening? Electrons and holes, they are becoming neutral. So, that process is nothing but recombination. So, when we talk about generation, simply we have to say that electrons in the valence band, when they are given sufficient energy, they'll take that energy and they'll go to conduction band. Then one free hole and one free electron will be generated. Hole in valence band and electron in conduction band. Whereas when we talk about this recombination process, in recombination, what exactly will happen? Electron which is present in the conduction band or electron which is already in excited state, it is going to lose its energy or it is going to combine with free hole in valence band. So, this is about generation and recombination. Now, coming to next question, list the materials which are used to fabricate direct and indirect band gap semiconductors. So, here we have to write that when we talk about this indirect band gap semiconductors, generally we'll make use of elemental semiconductors. So, when we talk about these elemental semiconductors, we have silicon and germanium. So when we talk about these elemental semiconductors, we have silicon and germanium. Whereas when we talk about this direct band gap semiconductors, we make use of compound semiconductors. And these compound semiconductors, they have one more name also. They can also be called as direct band gap semiconductors. So they are called as direct band gap semiconductors. Now, I think we have idea about elemental semiconductors, which belong to group 4 elements and which consists of single atoms. And whereas for direct band gap semiconductors, here, of course, what we are going to do, we are going to combine different elements belonging to different groups. So here, what we are going to do here is, I'll take one element from third group and one more element from fifth group. So when I combine two elements, one element coming from third group and one element coming from fifth group, then these two elements together, they are going to form direct band gap semiconductors. Or I can also go for combination of second group and a sixth group from periodic table, or we can also combine two elements belonging to fourth group. And by doing so, our whole and sole intention is, what is the intention behind combining such elements? Our intention is to make our energy band gap equal to h nu. So here, which is energy difference between conduction band and valence band, that should be equal to energy of photon. Okay, so that when these direct band gap semiconductors are forward biased, energy will be released in the form of the photons. And these direct band gap semiconductors, they are used in order to make LEDs and laser diodes. And coming to next question, explain biasing of a semiconductor material. Show how they are connected in forward and reverse biasing. So what exactly we mean by biasing? So biasing is nothing but applying external voltage to PN junction diode. So here in this case, what we are going to do, simply I'll take PN junction. So this is our PN junction. Here we have our PN junction. This is P-type and N-type semiconductor. And when we apply external voltage, so application of external voltage to PN junction diode, so that process, it is called as biasing. Okay, and how we are biasing a PN junction diode? So first type of biasing is forward biasing. In forward biasing, simply what we are going to do, P type of PN junction is connected to positive terminal of battery, whereas N type of PN junction, it is connected to negative terminal of battery. And talking about reverse biasing, here it is completely opposite to forward biasing. So in this case, what we are going to do, P type of PN junction, it is connected to negative terminal of battery, and N type of semiconductor, it is connected to positive terminal of battery. And one point what we have to understand here is, when our PN junction diode is forward biased, it will act as conductor, and when it is reverse biased, it will act as insulator. Now next, list the applications of direct and indirect band gap semiconductors. So when we talk about these direct band gap semiconductors, as I have already told that these semiconductors, during recombination process or when electron comes down from conduction band to valence band, they are going to release energy in the form of photons. So that's why when we talk about these direct band gap semiconductors, so these direct band gap semiconductors, they are used in order to make LEDs and laser diodes. So LEDs and laser diodes, where there is conversion of electrical energy to light energy. And coming to this indirect band gap semiconductor, here recombination time of indirect band gap semiconductor is a little bit larger compared to direct band gap semiconductor. So that's why they are used to amplify signals. So mainly they are used to amplify signals in transistors, rectifiers, and of course in amplifiers. So they are used to amplify signals in transistors, rectifiers, etc. So in electronic devices. So here we have our rectifiers. Then coming to next definition, recall different techniques used for the formation of PN junction diode. So here we have three techniques using which we can form a PN junction diode. First technique, it is called as grown junction type. So first technique, it is called as grown junction type. And then second one is of course, we have alloyed or fused junction type. So alloyed or fused junction type. And coming to this third type of method to form p-n junction diode, which is widely used, is diffused junction type. So this method, it is called as diffused junction method of forming p-n junction diode. Now next, define depletion layer. So already I have told you, when p-n junction is formed, because of diffusion of charge carriers, a layer is formed in which we have charge carriers which do not have any energy. So there is a layer which is depleted of free charge carriers. That layer, it is called as depletion layer. And if you want to draw VI characteristics of diode, so when we talk about this VI characteristics of diode, here simply what we are going to do here is, of course, I just have told about forward biasing and reverse biasing. First, when we talk about the forward biasing, when I apply forward voltage, then we have to measure our forward current in milliamps. So initially, what we are going to observe here is, even though voltage is increasing, there won't be any change in the current. But after some time, there will be sudden rise in the current. And this sudden rise, it occurs at one particular forward voltage, which is called as threshold voltage. Because we know that in forward biasing, depletion layer will be decreased, and at one particular voltage, it will be completely eliminated. Whereas in reverse biasing, when we go for reverse biasing, when we apply reverse voltage, then there is very small current, and that current, it will be in microamps. So that current, it will be in microamps, and that current, it is because of minority charge carriers. So that current, it is called as leakage current. But if I go to very high reverse bias voltage, then breakdown of junction takes place. Junction will get destroyed and we'll have a large reverse current flowing across the diode. Now next is draw the circuit of a forward biased p-n junction diode. So when we talk about forward biased p-n junction diode, generally what we are going to do, we are going to take a variable power supply, right? And in this circuit, we are going to keep one resistor, and then we have ammeter, and generally it will be milliammeter. And then here we are going to connect our diode, okay? And of course, positive, this is p-type and this is n-type. So p-type, it is connected to positive terminal, n-type, it is connected to negative terminal. And across this, we are going to connect voltmeter. Okay, so this is the circuit diagram, forward biased p-n junction diode. Then what are elemental and compound semiconductors? Already I have discussed. So elemental semiconductors, we can take their examples as silicon and germanium. Coming to compound semiconductors, we have gallium arsenide, indium phosphide, like this, even silicon carbide. These are all examples of compound semiconductors. Now, why Zener diode is used as voltage regulator? Here, of course, when we talk about voltage regulator, no matter if there are any fluctuations in the input voltage, so output voltage out of the Zener diode, it is going to be constant. And here in this case, why we are using it as voltage regulator is because in Zener diode, we have one condition which is called as Zener breakdown. So what is Zener breakdown? As I have told you that if you take a normal diode and if we go for high reverse bias voltage, then whatever covalent bonds are present, those bonds are going to break, all those electrons, they are taking part in conduction. So that's why there will be sudden rise in current. But in Zener diode, what we are going to do here is, when Zener diode is reverse biased, then I don't have to go to very high reverse bias voltage for this breakdown, but at very small reverse bias voltage itself without damaging diode, I'm going to have lot of current flowing across the junction. And this property of Zener breakdown, it is used in voltage regulator. Then why do we need a suitable material for light emitting diode? Because we know that in a light emitting diode, generally it's a forward biased diode, and when we take the symbol of light emitting diode, just will show two arrows going outside like this, and it is a forward biased diode. And during forward biasing, we know that if you forward bias a diode, so this is p-type and this is n-type, here we have holes, here we have electrons. And when we forward bias it, okay, holes, they are moving towards the n-type, and similarly electrons, they are moving towards the p-type. Now here recombination takes place. We know that during recombination, electron, it is going to come from conduction band to valence band. So here release of energy takes place. And in order to get light out of it, So I have to maintain this energy band gap to be equal to energy of photon, which is not possible with normal semiconductors. So that's why I have to make use of specially made materials called as compound semiconductors or direct band gap semiconductors in order to make this LED where energy gap is equal to h nu. And here mentioned different types of LED materials along with different radiant colors. So here we can talk about different materials like gallium arsenide, then indium phosphide, then we have gallium arsenic arsenide. Okay, so all these materials, they are going to display different colors based on what type of material we are using to make them. Then illustrate any two differences between LED and photodiode. So first difference, we can write that light emitting diode, it's a forward bias diode. Photodiode is reverse bias diode. And light emitting diode, its input is electrical energy, output is light energy. Whereas photodiode, its input is light energy and output is electrical energy. And when we talk about these symbols, if we take LED, generally we'll show it as arrows going outside. So this is a symbol for LED. Whereas when we talk about photodiode, we have to show light energy as input energy. And then one more thing what we have to show here is, of course, apart from forward biasing and reverse biasing, in light emitting diode, they are not just made with normal conductors, but they are made with direct band gap semiconductors. Whereas photodiode, it is made with elemental semiconductors like silicon and germanium. Next, compare the principle behind working of LED and solar cell. So here, LED, light emitting diode, as I told you, forward biased PN junction diode, which is made with special type of semiconductors where recombination process takes place. Whereas in case of solar cell, so here we are not biasing our PN junction diode, it is a reverse bias diode. And here in this case, of course, our input is not electrical energy just like LED. Here input energies are solar light, sunlight, and it is going to convert that sunlight into current. And one more thing here, a process which is involved in solar cell is generation of electron hole pair, whereas in light emitting diode, it is recombination. Now draw the circuit of reverse bias PN junction diode. So here in this case, of course, when we talk about reverse biasing, here also we'll have resistor followed by microammeter. And then we have our diode, okay, where P-type is connected to negative terminal, N-type is connected to positive terminal. And of course, we have your voltmeter, which is connected across the diode. Next, advantages of avalanche photodiode. Now we have seen that in photodiode, of course, we are going to increase reverse current by making light intensity fall on the depletion layer. But here in avalanche photodiode, what we are doing here is, first of all, of course, here we are making use of this materials which are heavily doped. Here we are not just using P-type and N-type material, but we are maintaining different regions. And because of those regions, what we are going to find that even at a low reverse bias voltage, there will be multiplication of charge carriers. So we are going to get a high reverse current even at a low reverse bias voltage. And what is the phenomena involved here? Here we have avalanche effect, or we can also say that it is multiplication of electron hole pairs. So where one electron or one formation of one electron hole pair, it is going to stimulate emission of further electron hole pairs. So one free electron, it goes and it will make one covalent bond to break again. Two electrons come out, these two electrons again, they are going to break further covalent bonds. So this process continues and we'll have lot of charge carriers we can also call it as ionization. Then mention the industrial applications of solar cell. Here we know that solar cell, because we are going to get current, so mainly for current purpose it is used. And of course for converting our solar light into electrical current. And materials used, so special type of materials they are going to use, cadmium sulfide, and then of course we can make use of even this gallium arsenide material. So there are special type of materials, and these materials, they should have a higher band gap and a higher conductivity. So such type of materials are used to make solar cells. And coming to VI characteristics of photodiode, so here we are mainly focusing on reverse voltage and then we are taking reverse current, and this reverse current, it is taken in micro amps. And here first we are going to have dark current. So dark current, when there is no light intensity, and as light intensity increases, what is happening with reverse current? Reverse current is going to increase. So this dark current, it is because of leakage. This it is also called as leakage current, that current due to minority charge carriers. And this is when I keep on increasing light intensity. Suppose if it is lumen 1, then this is for lumen 2 and this is for lumen 3. So as light intensity increases, reverse current also increases. So this is about short answer questions. And then coming to long answer questions, write notes on direct and indirect band gap semiconductors. Already I have discussed when I have discussed short answers. Here elaborately we have to write about them. And you have to talk about even direct recombination, indirect recombination. So just have seen in short answers, first we have to discuss that if we take a direct band gap, we have direct recombination. And one point what we have missed in previous discussion is when we try to explain them using EK diagram. So what we have to say here is in direct band gap semiconductors, here generally EK curve when we take, this is our conduction band. And this is our valence band, and this is the minimum value of conduction band which is occurring at momentum vector k1. So this one energy I'm taking with respect to momentum vector k, and this is the minimum value of conduction band, and this is the maximum value of valence band which occurs at k2. And here we have our electron, here we have our hole, so here it will come down like this. So in case of direct band gap semiconductors, k1 is equal to k2. Whereas in case of indirect band gap semiconductors, so what we are going to observe here is, so here in this case, minimum value which is occurring at momentum vector k1, so this is our conduction band, this is our valence band, and here maximum value of k2, so actually this is the minimum value, not this one, so this is our minimum value, they don't occur at the same point, so here k1 it is not equal to k2. Okay, so that process, this process in direct band gap, it is called as direct recombination, where electron in conduction band, it will come back to its original vacant site. Whereas in case of indirect band gap semiconductors, it won't come. And here what we are going to observe here is in indirect band gap semiconductors, here traps will be present, and these traps, they are going to hold electron coming from conduction band for some time, and then electron, it will come to valence band. So here recombination time is more in case of conduction band. And we know that coming to this application part, here direct band gap semiconductors, they are used in order to make LEDs and laser diodes, whereas this indirect band gap semiconductors, they are used to amplify signals in transistors and rectifiers. And here special type of materials are used to make direct band gap, those are called as compound or direct band gap semiconductors. Whereas this indirect band gap semiconductors, they are used to using the elemental semiconductors like silicon or germanium. And here what is forward biasing? Draw circuit diagram and explain. So already we have taken, just quickly if I try to recollect it, we know that what is PN junction. And already have drawn even circuit also. So PN junction, when PN junction is connected to positive terminal, N type of PN junction is connected to negative terminal. Then we have our holes from P side going to N side and electrons from N side coming to holes. And here both electrons and holes, they are going to lose their energy. They are going to combine. They are going to become neutral. Here recombination takes place. And one more thing, in depletion layer, whatever immobile charge carriers are there, they are going to gain energy. Okay, from that forward biasing, and there will be flow of current. So it will act as a good conductor when we forward bias PN junction. And the process of diffusion and drift, of course, diffusion already have told you, once we form PN junction, there will be flow of charge carriers from higher concentration to lower concentration. And the current which is produced because of diffusion of charge carriers is diffusion current. Now coming to drift current, where there is flow of charge carriers, or where charge carriers, they are going to move, or they are going to conduct current on application of external electric field by force. When charge carriers are made to move by force, that current, it is called as drift current. And already have discussed about formation of PN junction layer, where we talk about diffusion as well as formation of depletion layer, and then how potential barrier is formed. And reverse biasing also we have discussed. In reverse biasing, if we take our PN junction, so this is our PN junction, where P type, it is connected to negative terminal, N type is connected to positive terminal. Holes, they get attracted towards the negative terminal of battery, and electrons in n-type, they get attracted towards the positive terminal of battery. And here in this case, as you can see, because they are moving away from depletion layer it is going to get increased. And here, because there will be, what do you mean by depletion layer being increased? It means that it is depleted of free charge carriers. So that's why during reverse biasing, it will act as insulator, or it has got very small current due to minority charge carriers, that current it is called as leakage current. And then draw graphic symbol of crystal diode, explain its significance, and how do you determine the VI characteristic. So this already I have discussed when I have discussed short answers. Zener diode. So when we talk about this Zener diode, we know that Zener diode, it is, of course, it is just like our PN junction diode, but here P-type and N-type semiconductors are heavily doped. So here P-type and N-type semiconductors are heavily doped, and here in generally if we take a normal diode, depletion layer is very thin. But in case of this Zener diode, what we are going to observe here is in case of normal diode, depletion layer is thick. But in case of Zener diode, depletion layer is very thin. So that's why even when we reverse bias it, what we are going to observe here is, well, first of all, it has got plenty of majority charge carriers because of heavy doping. And also depletion layer is also thin. So that's why what we are going to observe here is in Zener diode, Zener breakdown takes place at low reverse bias voltage where there is increase in the reverse current. Suppose if I try to compare reverse biasing with normal diode, then what we are going to observe here is, suppose this is our reverse voltage and this is our reverse current, then in case of Zener diode, Zener breakdown, it is going to take place at low reverse bias voltage. So this is Zener breakdown, whereas if I take a normal diodes, then we are going to find this avalanche breakdown, or this breakdown voltage, if you take normal breakdown in diodes, it is going to occur at high reverse bias voltage. So there is increase in reverse current even at low reverse bias voltage without affecting the diode. And this property, it is used for voltage regulation. And here, explain energy band diagram of PN junction diode. So already in my video, I have explained. So in energy band diagram, when we talk, generally we'll take a P-type. Suppose if this is conduction band and valence band in a P-type of PN junction, and this is, of course, here we have our energy band diagram, and generally we'll represent depletion layer like this. This is our depletion layer, so these are the energy levels. So this is conduction band and valence band in N-type of PN junction. And generally, conduction band and valence band in P-type, they are represented by ECP, EVP. And here it is represented as ECN, EVN. And we know that in N-type, we have electrons in conduction band as majority charge carriers. Here we have holes in valence band of P-type of PN junction. And because of diffusion of charge carriers, Fermi level, it will become constant throughout the PN junction. But still, Fermi level, it is closer to valence band in P-type and it is closer to conduction band in N-type. And always conduction band and valence band in P-type, it will be a little bit higher than conduction band and valence band in N-type. And then show the application causes exponential increase. Already we have discussed, and already I told you what is Zener voltage or breakdown voltage. Then avalanche photodiode. So in avalanche photodiode, we have seen that which has got different layers. So first we'll take a P region, N region, which is followed by an intrinsic region. And this P region and N region are heavily doped. So and here in this case, so what is the main phenomenon which is going to increase reverse current compared to normal photodiode is multiplication of charge carriers. Then LED, we know what is LED. It's a forward bias PN junction diode. I told you that it is made with a special type of semiconductor. So that here, what is the phenomena involved, principle involved is recombination, where electron from conduction band, it will come back to valence band, it is going to lose its energy, and that energy comes out in the form of photons. So that's why this LED is going to convert electrical energy into light energy. And already I have compared LED and photodiode. So in LED, recombination process, in photodiode generation takes place, and this is forward bias, reverse bias, all those points are already discussed. Now coming to photodiode. So what is photodiode? Already I told you that it's a reverse biased diode, and this reverse biased diode, of course here depletion layer is thick. So once we take this photodiode, this is our p-type and n-type, and this is our junction layer. So here we have our holes and here we have our electrons. We have thick depletion layer, and generally, so this is our thick depletion layer. So p-type, it is connected to negative terminal, and n-type is connected to positive terminal. Then what we are going to do, we are going to expose this depletion layer to light intensity. So here we have immobile charge carriers without energy. Now these charge carriers, they are going to gain energy from the photons which are coming from this light. So once they gain energy, they start moving, and that's why you will have a reverse current flowing across the junction. And reverse current intensity, this magnitude of reverse current, it will increase with increase in the intensity of incident light. Then so how it can be converted? Photodiode can be converted into PIN and avalanching. PIN diode, simply what we are going to do, so I'll take a p-type and this is n-type, and in between p-type and n-type, we are going to insert one more region, which is intrinsic layer, which is undoped. So our intention is to make thick depletion layer so that we can have spontaneous photon absorption in order to increase response time. So in order to have faster response time and wider spectral response, we have increased depletion layer by inserting a region of intrinsic layer. And whereas already discussed about avalanche photodiode, so here we have different layers. We have P region and then N region, then here also one more intrinsic region is inserted, and here also we have this P region. These are heavily doped. We have intrinsic region, and what is the phenomenon generally which is going to increase our depletion layer is multiplication of charge carriers. Then this LED already we have discussed. VI characteristics also of solar cell. So here main phenomena is of course conversion of sunlight into current without biasing PN junction. And one more thing what we have to understand here is, in case here also generation of electron hole pairs takes place, and here main current flow, it is because of voltage, formation of voltage across the depletion layer. Then solar cell also we have, and about silicon and gallium arsenide we have discussed. Now coming to part C of question bank, where we are going to do numerical problems. Already in one of my video, I have with solutions, I have done all this problem. So just quickly, we'll try to see what is the exact formula for solving this problem. Now generally all these problems, they are based on two formulas. One formula is diode equation. We have a diode equation. So one formula we have to remember. So what is the diode equation? Diode equation, it is given as I is equal to Is into exponential EB by beta KT whole minus 1. So this is our diode equation. And what is I? I, it is called as forward current. So this is forward current. And this one is reverse saturation current. So this is our reverse current. This is reverse. And then coming to this exponential term, E is charge of electron, V is our forward voltage. So E is our forward voltage, and of course K is Boltzmann constant. What is the value of Boltzmann constant? K, it is given as 1.38 into 10 to the power of minus 23 joule per Kelvin, and T is our temperature, absolute temperature, temperature in Kelvins, and beta. What is beta? Beta, it is called as ideality factor. It is also called as numerical constant. And generally, it will have different values depending upon what type of material is used in order to make our diode. So generally, if suppose value of beta is not given in numerical, then we have to assume it to be 1. So now based on this equation, many problems are given. So if we take first problem here in this case, we need to find forward voltage. So we have to find V value. IS value is given, which is 50 microamps. So 50 microamps means 50 × 10⁻⁶. And here forward current is also given, which is 2 amps. And here in this case, E by KT value is given directly. So E by KT value is given 40. And we need to find V value. So forward voltage, right? And beta value, because it is not given, we have to assume it to be 1. And then after rearrange the terms, we can get V value. And coming to second problem, in this problem, what is given? So here in this problem, we were given value of, because here, this current, it is in microamps, it means that we are talking about reverse current. So it is 0.18 micro. Micro means 10⁻⁶ amps. And apart from that, we were given forward current value, which is forward voltage value, which is 0.98 volts. And temperature is also given, but it is given in Celsius. So when we add it, so we are going to get 300 kelvins. Okay, and what we are supposed to find, we are here also, we have to find value of current, forward current. So we need to find the value of forward current. So same formula. Then coming to third problem, here this value is our forward voltage, and then we need to get forward bias current. We need to find the value of I, and we were given value of IS, and here thermal voltage is given. So here this, when we talk about thermal voltage, which is 25.2 millivolts, but what is thermal voltage? So when we try to write diode equation in terms of thermal voltage VT, so it is written as KT by E. So this value is KT by E. And if we try to modify diode equation based on thermal voltage, so I is equal to IS into exponential. So here it will become V by beta VT. VT is our thermal voltage whole minus 1. So this VT value is given. So directly we can substitute in our formula. And in the second case, as you can observe here, beta value is given. So ideality factor value is given. So we have to take beta 1.5. And we were given value of forward bias voltage, and we were given value of forward current, and also we were given value of temperature. But what we need to find? We need to find reverse current. And coming to fifth problem. In this problem also, of course, we are given value of forward current, reverse current, which is 10⁻⁰ amps. Ideality factor is given 1.5. Temperature is also given. You need to find the value of voltage. Now coming to sixth and seventh questions. In the sixth and seventh questions here, we need to find a wavelength of gallium arsenide, which has got band gap of 1.52 electron volts. So coming to this sixth and seventh problem, so what is the formula we are going to use? Formula is Eg is equal to hν. Here we are talking about direct band gap semiconductors. In direct band gap semiconductors, energy gap, it is equal to hν, which is equal to hc by lambda. So here lambda, it can be written as hc by Eg. So here we need to find lambda here. What is given? H is of course Planck's constant, which is 6.6 × 10⁻³⁴ joule second into what is the velocity of light? 3 × 10⁸ meters per second. And band gap value is 1.52, but it is given in electron volts. So we have to convert it into joules by multiplying it with 1.6 × 10⁻¹⁹ joules. So when we simplify, we are going to get value of wavelength. Whereas in second problem, it is reverse. Here we need to find band gap, but lambda value is given and it is in micrometer. So it will be 1.65 × 10⁻⁶ meters. And if I want to find band gap in electron volts, so what I have to do, H is of course 6.6 × 10⁻³ × 3 × 10⁸ divided by lambda is 1.65 × 10⁻⁶ into, in the denominator, we have to take 1.6 × 10⁻¹⁹. Then only we are going to get our band gap in electron volts. Then coming to next one, here also same diode equation, I is equal to IS exponential EV by beta KT minus 1 In this case, we were given value of reverse saturation current. We were also given forward current. We were given value of beta, and we were also given value of forward voltage, but we need to find temperature T. So just rearranging the terms. Now coming to 9th and 10th question. So here we, in 9th question, we were asked change in voltage, whereas in 10th question, we were asked ratio of final current to initial current. So for that, so as you can see, I is equal to Is exponential EV by beta KT minus 1. Now first, what I'm going to do here is, I'm going to change my forward voltage, then my forward current is going to change, but reverse current, it will be same. So here, when my forward voltage is V1, then what happens to this equation? This equation will become EV1 by beta KT. There is no change in temperature. So this is minus 1. So minus 1. Similarly, if I go to forward voltage V2, then current will become I2. Forward current will become I2, but reverse current will be as it is. So exponential EV2 by beta KT minus 1. And here, because this term is very large compared to 1, we can neglect this 1. And here we can write it as Is into exponential EV1 by beta KT. And whereas this equation, we can write it as Is into exponential EV2 by beta KT. Then after that, I'm going to divide I2 by I1. So if we divide I2 by I1, if we divide, then we end up having it as exponential E into V2 minus V1 by beta KT. So if you go to 10th problem, so in 10th problem, we were asked to find ratio of final current to initial current. And here V2 and V1 values are given. This is value of V1 and this value is V2. Okay, and apart from that, beta value is given. So temperature, we have to assume it to be 300 kelvins. So if we do it, we can find this ratio. Coming to 9th problem, here in this case, we were given I2 by I1 value. We need to find V2 minus V1. So that is change in voltage. So for that, what we have to do here is we have to take logarithms on both sides. So this will become I2 by I1. So this is E into delta V, which is change in voltage into beta KT. Now from this change in voltage will become beta KT by E into ln of I2 by I1. So this 9th numerical we can find using this problem. Here I1 value is of course 0.1 milliamps, whereas I2 value is 10 milliamps. And also we were given value of ideality factor. Ideality factor can be represented by eta, also it can be represented by beta. So these are the various questions that we can expect from semiconductor devices. I hope you are able to understand. So with this, I'm going to end my session here. Thank you.
Like, share and subscribe. Hit the bell icon for more updates.